and is, among many other things, the co-chair of Mission Blue and a whole list of other foundations that you can find on his Wikipedia page. And so with that, we're going to start with a little introductory video that will introduce you to this notion of ecocide. So if we can.
Mass damage and destruction of nature is increasingly known as ecocide, and there is a fast-growing global movement to make ecocide a crime at the international level, just like genocide. This initiative is already being engaged with by dozens of governments. Criminal law is often thought of as a framework for punishment. That's how it works, but that's not what it's for. Murder isn't a crime in order to punish murderers, it's a crime to stop people killing each other. Criminal law is protective law. It's what makes us safe. And the damage that our economic activity has been inflicting on the living world around us in recent decades, while largely unintended, is extremely dangerous to climate, to nature, and to people. And we're witnessing a rising global frustration with the slow pace of action to address this danger. There are many environmental regulations around the world, but they are often badly followed, woefully monitored, and poorly enforced. Multilateral environmental agreements, like the Paris Agreement, are not binding. So genuine action on sustainability and regeneration remains an uphill struggle against business as usual. And this is where ecocide law will be crucially useful. It strongly reinforces existing laws. A board of directors will approach its environmental obligations very differently, knowing that if it fails to fulfill them and threatens ecocide as a result, its members could be in criminal law territory. Ecocide law helps to shift our cultural mindset. When we place severe harm to nature at the same level as severe harm to people, we can better understand our responsibilities to the living world upon which we entirely depend and make decisions in a far more conscious way. Also, importantly, defining ecocide creates a useful lens through which industry can look to steer strategic change. The proposed legal definition is concise and clear. Ecocide means unlawful or wanton acts committed with knowledge that there is a substantial likelihood of severe and either widespread or long-term damage to the environment being caused by those acts. It's unreasonable to expect policymakers to know what each sector should do to become sustainable. It's eminently sensible, on the other hand, to give the experts within those sectors the framework they need to work it out. Ecocide law can be seen as the protective counterpart to rights law, both to nature rights being developed in many jurisdictions around the world, including the US, as well as to the human right to a clean, healthy, and sustainable environment. It's easy to understand this when we realize that our basic human right, the right to life, is protected by the fact that homicide is a crime. It's important that your country is part of this conversation as it develops around the world, as ecocide law presents both a concrete route to planetary security and a ground rule to level the playing field economically, one that goes beyond short-term electoral cycles and will help to steer a safe and just transition. We hope you will join us in driving this crucial global conversation in your own networks and sectors and with your politicians. Thank you.
So, John, Sylvia, how far should we go to protect the oceans?
You know, I think it's really an ethical question, and that's what we're going to talk about, and also the role of oceans in this. But before I do, you know, many of you know that she's also called Your Deepness, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And you think maybe that's because she spent more time under the water than everybody in this room combined.
I take a lot of showers.
No comment. But having known Sylvia as long as I have, I need to tell you that I have a different interpretation of her deepness. It's a profound respect for the interconnectivity of nature, which is really important to our discussion today. It's a profound wisdom, and it's her experience. So with that, let's get into a nice ethical discussion. Sylvia, if I may, let me just frame the first question. And that is, you know, we've been pretty good as a species taking care of ourselves. So we have a law that says that you can't kill people, homicide. We have a law that says you can't kill a whole bunch of people, it's genocide. So what do we do? What's our role in protecting nature? Where do we set the priorities?
Well, if you kill nature, you kill us as well. Ecocide is people-side, if you will. And making that connection, it's taken us a long time to know what we now know and make those connections. In fact, our prosperity, our success as a species has come through the consumption of nature. And in fact, all animals consume the world around them. We don't photosynthesize, so we have to eat something or somebody, or a lot of somebodies. And I think it's just been so built in to who we are as a species throughout all of our history. We consume nature, we call nature natural resources, and they're generally regarded as free for the taking. The air we breathe, the water, the land, the trees, and certainly ocean wildlife. It still has an accounting base of zero. A live fish, what's it worth? It's only a dead fish once you've captured it and marketed it that you can account for it. And clearly there are limits to how far you can go with that, because how much of the ocean, how many creatures that we take for commerce remain in 21st century, in the 2023, as compared to when I arrived on the planet, when there were only 2 billion people, now there are 8 billion people. And our consumption of wildlife on the land, as well as wildlife in the sea, has continued to scale up, not down. But I think we are the luckiest humans ever to arrive, because now we can see the consequences of our actions and relate what we're doing to nature to our own survival, our own prosperity, our own future. Now, if we want to live it up and say, okay, this is it, this will be the last century we have to worry about, 21st century, and then, you know, boom, it's over, then we should keep on doing what we're doing, flat out. Continue to cut the trees, kill the animals on the land and from the ocean. But that's not the expectation, is it? Where we want to go? Don't we want to have a long and enduring, prosperous future for ourselves? And if so, we've got to take care of what makes our existence possible. And we kind of get it for the land. We've been developing conservation codes of behavior and laws, endangered species, not just in the US, but we have this concept globally growing. We have to take care of it. But nature mostly has been defined as terrestrial systems. We're just beginning to wake up to the laws of nature. And that means, look at how does the planet work? And like it or not, we are obeying the laws of nature. Can't make this stuff up.
So, you know, when I think about what you've just said, it's the human perspective. It's what we can see, what we know. So we know the terrestrial world around us, but we don't know, you do, but we don't know all what's really at depth. So this whole ecocide movement that we're talking about today really was started from a terrestrial perspective.
Pope is on board.
Sorry?
The Pope is on board.
Absolutely, the Pope and a number of nations. So,
and Jane Goodall is on board.
And I'm
dozens
on board.
Of others.
So the question is, how do we help people focus on the importance of the ocean when we think about ethical questions like protecting nature? It's not just terrestrial. It ain't just the trees.
You know, the greatest ecosystem, the most of the living space on Earth starts at the surface of the ocean and has an average depth of 4+ kilometers, maximum 11 kilometers. The average depth is about where the Titanic rests on the ocean floor. And I think there's been, and still is, a rather widespread concept that the ocean is rocks and water, salt water. And the water is only useful if we can make it into fresh water, because we use fresh water. But actually, we use salt water a lot more, because the ocean, the living ocean, not just the water itself, but the living ocean, shapes climate and weather, planetary chemistry. There are plenty of places in the universe that have rocks and water. Water is not uncommon in the universe. The ocean is rare, maybe unique. It is unique in that it's filled with life. And so killing the life in the ocean affects the chemistry. It affects the nature of the planet as a whole. It really is the key. Earth is alive, not dead. And we're alive because the ocean is alive. And perversely, we just take the ocean for granted. I think we're just beginning to recognize from the surface to the greatest depths, the ocean is like a big minestrone. And all the little bits are somebody, you know, in this exchange of chemicals. And recently a study was commissioned by the International Monetary Fund, presented at the World Economic Forum about the value, just single out one big creature, or one group of the whales, okay? And looking at climate and whales, how could you make that connection? Because whales are big carbon-based units. Trees, big carbon-based units. People think about trees protecting forests because they capture carbon, sequester it in their roots in the soil, and they generate oxygen while capturing carbon. So how do whales fit into this? Well, the study wanted to put a dollar sign on the carbon value and the ecosystem value of whales. $1 trillion is what they came up with for live whales. Dead whales, not so much as compared to the living value, just related to carbon and climate. It goes like this. Whales consume, you know, krill, little fish, sometimes slurp up some of the phytoplankton, but whatever it is, it gets processed by the whale and gets returned back into the system as nitrates, phosphates, and, you know, the whole range of things you find in fertilizer that prospers, causes the phytoplankton to grow, like green things on the land, the cycle of life. You need to keep restoring the phosphorus, the nitrates, the sulfur, and so on. And so you get all the green stuff saying, yum, yum, we've got what we need. And they churn out oxygen, they keep capturing the carbon, keep providing the food that generates the krill, that generates the little fish, that generates the whales. So the cycle goes round and round. Big, big discussions at the World Economic Forum about whale poop. I mean, I'm serious. They did. And but it, if it works for whales, why not for tuna? Why not for shrimp? Why not for copepods? Why not for every living thing? There is no waste in nature. We are the great innovators by considering that waste is waste. And we've got to get with nature, look at how nature works, and do a better job of finding harmony. Did I say enough?
Okay, so nature is really good at organizing itself, but what kind of a job do we do? So, Sylvia, we have UNCLOS, the UN Convention of the Law of the Sea.
The U.S. is not a ratified nation.
Among other things. We have BBNJ, the Biodiversity Beyond National Jurisdictions. We have the New High Seas Treaty. Do those work? Aren't those enough? We've got treaties. Doesn't it work? Why are they not protecting nature? Because clearly they are not.
Because nature has a dollar sign on it. Even though we don't account for it properly, we can sell water rights without understanding that all living things need water. And we like to sort of take charge because we can see our need for water. We don't necessarily see the need for nature or the need for other creatures for water as well. So I think there was an excuse to be, call it arrogant or call it ignorant, whatever you want to call it. We did not know until, I think we've never known more or better or have the understanding of how we are a part of nature, not apart from it, that there's no excuse anymore. We can't say we don't know. But we have embedded in our society laws that were made when we did not know, did not understand. We have habits. We have cultures dependent on certain, you know, food habits, cultural. I have my mother's cookbook that uses wild goose fat to make molasses cookies. Come on, we don't take wild goose to make molasses cookies anymore. There aren't that many wild geese around. And it wasn't because there's a law, it's because the laws of nature, you know, if you take down to a certain point, you can't have it as a commercial enterprise anymore, or even a, whether it's commerce or individual. We have to adapt to the reality of the 21st century. So, I mean, I wholeheartedly embrace respect for anybody's culture, their habits, and even the laws. But I insist that we just have to look at the reality of what Earth is today. This is not, people tell me sometimes, they say they think I came from another planet, and I said, well, I did. I came from a planet that no longer exists, doesn't. I mean, I came along just at the edge of a time when wild birds darkened the sky. I can remember, I can hear them as they flew in such numbers. It was like a river of birds over my head. This was in New Jersey when I was, you know, 5 years old. And it, as they traveled across the country, they did what whales do. They fertilized the land, not the sea. And thinking that we're newcomers on these ancient systems that go back, you know, until the beginning of life on Earth, and certainly in the ocean more than on the land. But we are just taking what has taken literally 4.5 billion years to form, and it's only taken us 4.5 decades or so to significantly, certainly 4.5 centuries, go back to the 1500s, when there were 500 million people. 500 million. And already there were signs that we were causing trouble with wildlife. And just track from then to now how much of nature has been lost while we have increased. I mean, almost half of the land is now devoted to agriculture. Almost half of the land. 97% of the ocean is open for extraction of wild animals. Not all of it is taken from all that area, but just we're consuming the systems that have taken so long to form and so quickly causing the decline. So wouldn't we want to protect the systems that keep us alive now that we know? Shouldn't we be flat out saying, how can we look at the laws that exist, the perverse subsidies for killing ocean wildlife, the perverse subsidies that keep agriculture on the land just continuing to degrade the land? But it seems like such a good idea, did at the time, but is it a good idea now? And what can we do about it? Can we change the laws? Can we change our behavior? We need laws, but we also need a change in our attitude.
So, Sylvia, I hear you saying that we need to look at the injury to the ocean in particular as more than just an economic harm. Is that what you're saying?
Duh.
Okay. And so should we be telling people that you have a personal responsibility for the harm you've inflicted, even if everyone can't see it? Is that your sense?
We all make choices every day about what to eat, what to wear, how to travel. You know, everybody says, oh, I'm just one person, what can I do? The problems are so big, but it takes everybody. One person cannot do it all. But times 8 billion, little things add up. And even without laws, we can change our behavior. But we do need the laws to enforce bad behavior, because it only takes a small number of individuals to cause a lot of trouble for everybody. So
yeah, well, let's pick up on that. Fish. What fish are caught, Sylvia, using bottom trawling? Sole?
Bless my soul, yeah.
Okay. So, all right, let's think about that for a second. So for those of people who have eaten one of those recently.
Halibut.
There you go. Lovely big halibut. So here's the deal. Bottom trawling destroys the ecosystems there. That's a given. The next thing is it releases greenhouse gases, CO2, more than the entire airline industry. So what do we look at? What's our role as an individual choosing a fish or permitting bottom trawling?
People don't know. They don't. I mean, fish are just... My beloved National Geographic has done a great series on food. And they talk about chickens, they talk about beef, and they talk about fish. And what's the footprint of these? Talking about carbon, talking about climate. So beef, that's one species, that's cows. I mean, variations on the theme. Chickens, that's basically one species. And fish, that's 33,000 species that we lump together and call them fish. So we don't have Kentucky Fried Bird. It's probably chicken. Hamburger is probably beef. Not always. But who are you eating? We should ask that. I mean, everybody can ask that. Who are you? I mean, even with the individual cows, every creature is an individual. And we just need to get our heads on straight and think about not just what we're eating, but who are you eating? How old are you? Most of the animals that are cultivated for consumption are really young. We eat lamb. We don't eat big old sheep. Sometimes you do, but mostly the market is for creatures that eat plants and grow fast and don't mind crowding and that are hardy. We've boiled down the X number of mammals that exist, a few thousand, and 9,000 or so. And it's just a handful that we cultivate. It tastes good, grow fast, eat plants, and you know are pretty healthy and hardy. But just imagine growing lions and tigers, putting them in a herd. I mean, you couldn't even find that many lions and tigers. But in the ocean, where are the equivalents? Actually, tuna is far further up the food chain than terrestrial carnivores, because tuna eats fish that eats fish that eats fish. All of them are carnivores. All are eating other animals. Finally, after you get down this twisted food chain over years, not just a matter of months, as you do with chickens and cows and pigs and sheep, maybe a year, sometimes 2 years, but not 10 years or 20 years or 50 years or 100 years. Halibut can be 100 years old. A tuna takes at least a bluefin about 10 years to mature, let alone to be big enough to... We take the big ones. We take the old ones. We take them from deep water where they may be 50, 60 years old. Take maybe 10 years or 20. Or sharks take on the order of somewhere between 15 and 20 years to mature. And sharks live as long as humans. The largest, longest lived vertebrate that we know about is a shark, the Greenland shark, maybe 500 years old. Wouldn't you like to know their secrets? but we're taking them not just to eat, although that's the primary destination for most ocean wildlife that we don't think of as wildlife. We think of them as seafood, not wildlife. Biggest wildlife trade on the planet, we call seafood. Anyway, am I ranting too much?
No, because you didn't call them wildlife, and that's what they are.
I did call them wildlife.
Okay. Yeah.
So, like you, you're very wild.
So let's look at this another way. One of the things that occurs to me when we have this discussion is how much we're shooting ourselves in the foot.
Flippers.
So if I look at mangroves, which is one of my passions these days, about 50% of the mangroves have been destroyed in the last 50 years. We tear them up to put up resorts or make fish ponds and things like that. But they provide great value to us and to nature. So clearly they are the nurseries for fishes in our ocean.
Singular.
Thank ocean. You. I just passed the test with Sylvia. Oh, thank God. And they sequester more carbon, 4 times more than the Amazon rainforest. They protect us from storms. They take the brunt of them. We talked about the Bahamas last night and what happened to them about 6 years ago. So when we destroy something like that, we're destroying nature and we're also hurting ourselves. So Sylvia, when are we going to get our act together?
Well, let's start. Like, why not now? Come on, get on board.
So, John, Sylvia, where do you think the moral notion of ecocide, putting the destruction of the life in our ocean on par with other sentient creatures, where does that fit into our approach to protecting the ocean as something more than just an economic value?
Could I start that you're the expert, but I can say that the first time that I heard the term ecocide was in the Persian Gulf War, when Saddam Hussein was blamed for ecocide for destroying the oil wells in Kuwait and just flooded the desert and the ocean. And in so doing, the connection was it destroyed the livelihoods and the lives of people. And the marsh people, in connection with all that, again, another example of ecocide, the Tigris and the Euphrates, that was a target for destruction, because destroy the environment, you destroy the enemy. And the most recent time that I heard about ecocide was this week, when the dams, the big dam in Ukraine, thank you, was destroyed, and it was heralded as an act of ecocide, because it has not just harmed the environment, but also had a profound effect, is having a profound effect as we sit here on the people, a deliberate act of harming nature. And in the consequence, it harms humans.
Okay, and when we heard JoJo speak earlier, we were thinking about basically flipping the argument, the burden of proof, if you will. Today, somebody can go out and do something terrible, and unless you can prove that they've done it, they get away with it. Why don't we ask that they prove that they're not going to harm before they do it? Let's set our priorities right.
Like bottom trawling.
Precisely, and some other things we're going to talk about a little later. So for me, it is an ethical question. And so when I think one of the things that resonated with me in JoJo's presentation is this provides an ethical framework for our species to do what we do. It's a warning to people who don't consider nature. And I think that's the great value, is it's not going to court or suing somebody. It's saying, we as a society now agree that this is not acceptable. And I think that's the important first step.
So the question is, where are we with respect to making ecocide, if that's the right term, to making liability for such behavior? It's not like the EPA, it's like the whole world.
Like a number of things, it's a political process. So there, thank you, Pope Francis, for supporting this, but a number of other countries have done so as well. The European Union is considering establishing ecocide as a law within the EU. Belgium and a number of other countries are taking the lead. So when JoJo closed the message on her little video, it was, please speak to your countries. So we're in the US, we need to let the US know. US doesn't sign a lot of these international treaties, unfortunately. That's something that we ought to be concerned about. But for those of us who come from other places, we definitely need to talk to our governments.
This is partly a moral, ethical, common sense, you name it. But I'm intrigued that Pope Francis is on board, because we do need laws to, mostly not for the public at large, although it sets standards, but it's for the bad guys, if you will, the ones who don't have respect for others. They just are so focused on what their particular power is and how they can deploy it to their advantage, not thinking about all the rest of the world, to which all of us are just inextricably connected. You know, we think that we can live independent lives, but we are all dependent on everything that has preceded the present time, and everything that we do will affect the ability of those who follow to have at least the same level of choices, prosperity, health, security that we enjoy right now. So we need to be able to get outside ourselves and see what a miracle it is to be alive at all, and to try to respect what it takes, not only to keep this planet alive, but by so doing, we keep everything we care about alive.
And just a quick one. Mm-hmm. So the Earth is going to be just fine. It's been around a long time. It'll be around a long time. We won't if we keep doing what we're doing. And by ignoring nature and the interconnected part of this, that's the problem.
So the lesson you should all take from our talk today is that we need to redefine the ethical standard, the ethical norm. If you want to dig deeper in this topic, look at the economic concept of internalizing externalities that's building into the cost of killing that sea creature, not just the value of its flesh, but the harm to the ecosystem and our human loss of oxygen. Look at the iconic essay, The Tragedy of the Commons by Thomas Hardin. Look at the broad notion of the law of nature. There is a natural law theory popularized by John Locke. These are the things we have to start talking about to move the conversation away from this just being an economic harm, right? Because in order to define a duty to nature at our highest level, our greatest concern and responsibility, we have to move this conversation to other than just an economic injury. And so let's shift our conversation from the broad conceptual and philosophical to a specific case that we have the smallest window of opportunity to get out in front of in this redefining of our sense of obligation, and that is deep sea mining. So we're gonna show a 9-minute video that will frame this issue, and then we'll have another discussion. Alex?
Come sit over the side. Yeah.
What we are now proposing to do to mine the deep sea floor is permanent loss. What has taken literally millions of years to put into place. Why would we even think about doing such a thing? Ma, you are a whale whisperer.
Oh, a whisperer. I whisper a lot, but I have a whale of a time. I'm a cellist, so I do music, I do sound. You, I don't know, you tell the truth, you find the truth. You're a distinguished scientist, explorer, and witness to the ocean over decades.
I'm first and foremost a human being, curious. I become a scientist, observing carefully.
I see it. Oh, it's the bottom.
Reporting as honestly as I know how what I see, sharing the view as widely as possible. And through it all, just mindful of the miracle that we exist at all. Looking down into the ocean and seeing what looks like stars with all the illuminated life in the deep sea. It's just a privilege to be alive, to be aware of what my species is doing. I feel compelled to share the view that I've been privileged to have as an explorer going into the ocean. Earth is this biogeochemical miracle. It has taken 4.5 billion years for life to make this planet habitable for us. Climate is shaped by the ocean. Phytoplankton generates oxygen, captures carbon. More oxygen is generated from the sea than from the land. If you like to breathe, you'll listen up. The ocean, it's one continuous, living, dynamic system, like an orchestra of life. The greatest wilderness that remains on the planet is the deep sea. We once thought there's nothing down there. It's dark, it's cold, it's high pressure. What could possibly live there? We know now that most of life on Earth lives in the dark. The ocean is full of life, from the surface to the greatest depths. In that space from about 100 meters to 1,000 meters, below where divers can normally go, except in a submarine, there is, around the world, this greatest migration of life on Earth. Creatures from the deep come up to the surface at night to feed on the productivity that takes place in the sunlight, then sink back into the safety of the depths by day. Going down, it gets darker and darker, gets bluer and bluer. Finally, sunlight doesn't penetrate. High seas creatures, turtles, tunas, sharks, whales, these creatures, where do they get their groceries? Dive down into where the action is, this deep scattering layer of life. The deeper we go, the less we know, and the more discoveries we're finding.
The heck is that?
Oh my goodness.
We now have a new treaty, a legal framework to safeguard the global commons of the high seas. At the same time, there's another body of the United Nations that is saying there are minerals down there. A few companies, a few countries want to go into the deep sea and tear it apart for manganese nodules. I'm holding history in my hands. It's a manganese nodule. It's not just manganese, and it's just not a rock, although it's pretty dead right now. It's created in the deep sea, in the dark, under great pressure, the weight of 2 or 3 miles of ocean on top of it, slowly extracting the elements of the universe. And microbes, gradually over thousands of millennia, distilling little bits of the minerals to create what turns out to be a home for creatures in the deep sea. There's an octopus species who chooses manganese nodules as a place to brood her eggs. And I look at this little rock. I want to know, who are your neighbors? Who comes by for a visit? The deep sea. It's on the chopping block. Miners claim that nothing important lives there. It's the biggest land grab in the history of humankind. And it's happening underwater. They want to begin in the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, within the deepest, oldest body of water on Earth. Licenses to destroy vast areas of wilderness are about to be unleashed, once mining's proved, could spread throughout the seafloor. Hydrothermal vents and undersea mountains are their next targets. You may not realize it, but you and all the rest of life on Earth, we're in deep trouble.
You're talking about the last best chance to save the oceans.
Save ourselves.
That fate, in some ways, rests on the shoulders and decisions to be made in July on only 36 people.
The International Seabed Authority, governed by these 36 individuals, mm-hmm. who clearly have industrial inclinations.
Our journey is to drive the humankind through a wonderful adventure, which is to go very deep in the ocean to extract some minerals that are necessary for human activity on Earth. We are the only one at the moment who have the legitimacy and the authority.
Where's my voice? Where's your voice? Where are the kids?
Yeah.
Where are we represented?
You're talking about disastrous consequences if the oceans stop breathing. Let's then fast forward in time for our grandchildren, everybody's grandchildren. They will be living the consequences of whatever actions we take right now.
Exactly. It's the best chance we've ever got right now. We still have 10% of the sharks. Mm-hmm. Half the coral reefs are still in pretty good shape. The deep sea is still largely unscathed. Mm-hmm. But if we allow deep sea mining to proceed, it really puts our existence at risk. No ocean, no us. Harm the ocean, you're really harming us and the rest of life on Earth.
Wow. I feel like No Oceans, No Us should be on a t-shirt. So John, Sylvia, we have this opportunity, which can be framed as an ethical dilemma. we want to get away from internal combustion engines and all the harms that they create, move to electric cars, that requires all kinds of minerals. But that can't come at the expense of everything else. So how do we use the notion of creating penalties and responsibilities and a higher order sense of our duty to the ocean and to ourselves to reframe how we regulate deep sea mining?
Before we dive into that answer, you first, John, I want to acknowledge where that film comes from. It exists because a friend had the inspiration to put Yo-Yo Ma and me together, and Lavinia Currier, who tends to operate behind the scenes. She's a filmmaker, superstar, and she in turn enlisted her friends, mine too, Bob and Sarah Nixon, they're here with us, and Taylor Griffith happens to be my grandson, but he's a talented media guy as well. And this is a work in progress. We'll see as this evolves as a message, bringing science, policy, and art somehow together. And I just have to observe, I can't resist, this gathering started with a message from Jojo, and we're now in the midst of a discussion that features Yo-Yo. So let's go-go. John.
Having done a little work on deep sea mining over the years, basically it's her fault. She asked me at breakfast once, why don't we get involved and do the report for the IUCN, which we did. There are questions that we get to before we even think about the damage that we cause. So I want to put that on the table. Economically, does it even make sense? There, I won't go into all the details, but I'll leave it at that. It may not be profitable to do this, and that causes us all to think, what are the motivations behind the actors who are doing this? And I'll be glad to have a side conversation later with anybody about that. I have some views. So economically, it's probably stupid. The second is technical. We're talking 4,500 meters below the surface of the ocean. Okay, there have been some tests done, and I've observed those tests, and I've seen what's going on, and I've seen some significant problems that have happened. In one case, a machine dropped, and it broke off the umbilical and went down a few thousand meters. Another time, some communications didn't work, et cetera. We're really a long way away from doing this properly. Properly, and that's the key thing. Who are the cowboys and who are the good actors, or the better actors, if you will? But then we get to the potential damage, and it's not just the beautiful squid or octopus and the brittle stars that we see there. Like Sylvia, I have a couple of manganese nodules on my desk, and I can see the traces of a brittle star. I've been to the laboratory at the Natural History Museum in London, and under the microscope, I've seen the microsponges. That's important. And also, there are lots of details about how they're all interconnected. The mother of the sponges, and then surrounding them, all the subgenerations. But here's the one that worries me the most. There's about 30 to 40 centimeters of sediment that these manganese nodules sit on. So when you go scoop them up, however you're going to do it, you're going to be A, disturbing the sediment, but you're probably going to be sucking it up in the riser pipes that are going to take these nodules to the surface. So then what happens? There's something called dewatering. So you separate the nodules from the sediment and the water. Then what happens to it? There is some thought that if you just inject that back into the sea, and maybe not at the top of the water column, maybe halfway down or maybe all the way down, what happens? Well, first of all, that cloud could significantly impact and kill the biodiversity. That's at whatever level. But the other is has the potential to become what we call a carbon bomb. Is that what we need to be doing right now?
Right. This is directly analogous to nuclear winter. the reason why we have made so many efforts to prevent nuclear catastrophe. And now we're talking about doing it on purpose at the bottom of the ocean. For what? I guess that's the question.
Let me throw one in before I give it back to Sylvia. The nodule in Sylvia's hand was probably around 10 million years old. We've been around for how long?
Less.
So what gives our species, our generation of this species, the right to go take something that's taken so long?
You know, we can't put back.
And we can't put, let's talk about that. This is a geologic time frame, not a human time frame. So if I went out to Long Island, where we're going to go on Friday, and I cut down a forest and I put up a parking lot or a Walmart or something, okay? In 1,000 years, if I just left it alone, it's gone. It's grown over, it's disappeared. It's restored. That does not happen at 5,000 meters, okay? There were tests done decades ago and with deep sea mining. They've gone back. There's no recovery. There can't be recovery because it takes millions, tens of millions of years for the sediment to recover, for the biodiversity to come back, let alone for the nodules to be recreated. So what gives us the right at this window of time of this planet to do something like that?
So we're talking about the law here. The law currently allows it. Who makes the law? We do, or we don't. So I think the question is, what can we do to hit the pause button, at least, to encourage companies who would be using, are using, nickel, cobalt, copper, the things that are allegedly going to be derived from these nodules from the deep sea, and get them to use their power to the extent that you can influence governments, people. It's knowing. All of this has been brewing for decades, largely undercover. Most people, when you say, we're going to mine the deep sea, they say, so? Why should I care? They have no idea. No idea what the risks are for doing what, not just the metals company, there are a number of companies and countries lining up. And some of them are on this council, represented by the 36 individuals. Most of them haven't yet expressed one way or the other, but because they haven't, you have to think they might be inclined to go ahead with it. There are only 5 out of the 36 who have so far indicated that they will oppose it. So there's work to be done. If you have any connections, influence, you think you have no voice, look in the mirror and consider what your power is, and then think about how you can use it. I can't tell you what to do, but you can certainly find a way based on your own power.
So, John, reversing the burden of proof, how would that solve this problem?
Let me first say that today is World Ocean Day, or tomorrow is, but this is World Ocean Week. And I happen to know about a little country in the middle of Europe, very nice place that I come from, that I believe tomorrow will be making a significant announcement about this. And I hope we're not the only ones. So there is a movement, and there's been a lot of work behind the scenes, trust me. But we're not there yet. So the burden of proof. Today, the way it's worked, and I've been to the ISA, I've sat in what we call the cheap seats with the observers, where you're not really allowed to speak. And I've seen what's gone on, and I've met with the mining companies, I've met with the delegations of the states, and I've met with my colleagues in the cheap seats. The way it works today is we've spent decades at the International Seabed Authority trying to put the brakes on this by saying you're going to cause damage. And because it's an open question for some people, not for me, that's not listened to. I think potentially with the adoption of the ethical question of ecocide, that could actually get reversed. we talk about the precautionary pause. It's actually not in UNCLOS that I've been able to find, the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, but the precautionary pause. Until you know, stop. The fact of the matter is, what we do know has not been enough to stop the process. So that's been the burden on us. Why isn't the burden on the other side to prove you're not going to cause the damage?
So we got a late start, and we've had a remarkable conversation. Would really love for some of you, who I know have been sitting there thinking furiously, to weigh in. So in the back of the room first.
Yeah, well, I always love hearing the two of you speak about this. Never gets old. I'm Jeremy McCain, fellow explorer here. Sylvia, you've talked about that power. What is that power, that thing that we have? You've heard me say this before. There is no Superman or Superman of the ocean, but there is a Justice League, and we're all sitting in this room today. But as it turns out, Senator Bernie Sanders is actually sitting on some paperwork that a few of us ocean defenders have sent in that declares all minerals, polymetallic nodules, on the seafloor as conflict minerals. You want to know what you can do? Get on the phone, call Bernie Sanders' office now, tell him that you heard about this, and this needs to be in the Federal Registry. If this happens, this will prohibit anyone from owning, possessing, or transferring any polymetallic nodules in the United States. Why is this important? Because the metals company, which is the number one company that we saw in the film there that's pushing this, they've gotten a warning from the NASDAQ that if they keep that stock below $1, they will be delisted. This is not a business. This is not good for the environment. And with all of your help, we can make a massive impact today.
There you go. Don't mourn. Organize. There was a question over here. But, oh, great. Yep. Right there.
I'd like to address the elephant in the room, and that is human population. Just a couple of comments. When I was at the University of Texas, hook 'em horns, back in 1960, the population was 3 billion. It's more than doubled. It's politically incorrect to talk about the population bomb, but if the population keeps doubling, what we're saying here is virtually irrelevant. What do we do?
That's part of the discussion of the tragedy of the commons that needs to be the next chapter of this debate, this discussion, because this is only the beginning of all of your responsibility for doing even the tiniest little thing, a phone call to Bernie Sanders.
Alex? Well, don't you want to answer? Okay, I thought you want to answer the question, but thank you for having this conversation. As Dr. Earle probably remembers, last Climate Week we had Victor Vescovo actually give a talk on the financial unfeasibility of deep sea mining and also on the declaring metals conflict diamonds. I strongly suggest anybody who's interested in a really killer talk about that to find it on YouTube. Unfortunately, all of this is environmental economics, and environmental economics puts a dollar sign on everything, and we get the bottom line is we got to take it out of environmental economics and put it into a totally different environment and put really different value on things, right? So humans react to threat, not really, you know, to threat and self-interest. What is a threat to humans? As you said, most humans don't identify the ocean as something that they're really connected to. 250 million years ago, you were talking about millions of years, the Permian extinction extinguished a lot of the life on Earth, almost all of it. It happened because we think of volcanic eruptions, but also because bacteria started producing methane as opposed to eating methane. They're all on the seafloor in the clear and clipper fracture zone. And the thing that made them switch their metabolism was nickel enrichment. So what we're proposing, and this is MIT research, it's published, what we're proposing is to go and enrich that water again where all the most bacteria are to do exactly the same thing. That's a threat. How do we tell that story? We gotta tell
Go for it. You know that story. You should tell it. I mean,
well, I have done it.
Get it in
the
headlines.
The rest of you need to weigh in too.
Come on.
Yeah. So I just want to thank you guys, John, Sylvia, for this amazing event, and Bob and team for that incredible video with Yo-Yo Ma. What can I do? What can everybody in this room do? We heard call Bernie Sanders. I'm going to get his office number right after this. I went on the SaveTheHighSeas.org website per the video, but it's not allowing me to select a country to put in. But what else can I do as an individual right now today to make a difference, to help?
Write a letter, right? The easiest thing to do in the internet age is to go to some elected official or some newspaper's webpage, and it doesn't have to be long, it doesn't have to be detailed, it doesn't have to be brilliant. Just do it. If everyone writes a letter a month or a letter a year, just in this room, that changes the conversation.
And we change our behavior, because we commit to not buy an electric vehicle with minerals that have been made from this stuff. We go back to the bottom trawling. We don't eat halibut that has been bottom trawled. We make that decision when we go to a restaurant or when we go to the stores. We can't, it's so massive what we have to do. We can't do everything. But we all, as Sylvia said earlier today, we all can do something. So find that one thing that you'll do today that you'll change, and then do it again tomorrow with something else.
Well, I can't tell you, whoever you are, what you have the power to do. Only you know what that is. Jojo, Yo-Yo, Ma, his power is music. And he doesn't have to step out mm-hmm. and use his mighty powers to communicate a matter of concern. Lavinia Currier, great at telling stories with film, and all of those involved with making this little film. The Explorers Club could have said, no, you're not going to use our distinguished meeting place to talk about something and be rabble-rousers. But Ted Janulis said yes, using his power. So I just suggest, use your power. You know what the problem is. Take up your little piece of it. And the idea of conflict, minerals, brilliant. It's something that everybody can, you know, raise your hand and say, yeah, why are we doing this? Understanding that we could unleash this new era, new geological change. We're doing it anyway. We're in the Anthropocene, full speed ahead. But we can see what none of our predecessors and no other animals on Earth, as smart as elephants are, as intelligent as whales are, they don't know what even the 10-year-olds of today have available to them. Knowledge about who we are, where did we come from, where are we in the universe, what options do we have. Imagine if we didn't know. But knowing is only the beginning. You have to use that knowledge. It leads to caring, but caring, you can care, well, you can't care if you don't know, but a lot of people know. Individuals associated with a metals company, they've got the knowledge, but they choose to move in a different direction. Only a small number of people can move things in the wrong direction, but you can take an equally small number of people and move things in the other direction, and we are right there. This is crunch time.
We have time for two more quick questions, one and two.
Good. Let's go for it.
I actually don't have a question. My name is Sarah Nixon, and I wanted to just tell you that our job as filmmakers and working with Lavinia is to create tools for Sylvia and for all the organizations. So this tool will be made in different forms, a 9-minute form, a 3-minute form, a 1-minute form, a TikTok form, so that it's available to all organizations and for each one of them to put in their toolbox. And that's what we've been working on for the past, how many weeks since you gave us this order? 3 weeks? I don't know. But just so you know, that will be the tool. And at that moment, all these organizations have these tools that you're talking about. The Oxygen Project, et cetera, has right now started a campaign with the entire Deep Sea Conservation Coalition to have a letter that's already written in the language of that country. It's ready to go for you to just go online, put your info in there, and push the button. So over these next few weeks is critical. And so we're burning the midnight oil to give those tools to Sylvia and beyond. So go definitely see those websites. It should work for sure. All right, thanks, Sylvia.
Hello, everyone. Well, so I'm Daniel Caceres. I've been an observer at the International Seabed Authority. In the past three meetings with Sylvia, we presented over 250,000 signatures in our ocean in Panama this year. And the period and the moment that's critical is now in July. As you guys know, deep seabed mining is an activity that still does not occur. But now this year in July, from 24th to the 28th of July, is when the assembly is sessioning in Jamaica. And finally, after more than 40 years, they're trying to finish regulations for deep sea mining from the 28th to the 28th, from the 24th to the 28th of July in Kingston, Jamaica. So one of the things that we need more than just America is we need mobilization in Kingston, Jamaica in this session. The last past sessions, we had very little activism and very little presence from organizations there. We're trying to get more organizations present. We're trying to get more observers. We're bringing 8 Latin American youth to the ISA. We're bringing some Caribbean youth also in there, and we need more presence there. But also, we need a lot of influence from one specific country in this region, and that is Mexico. Mexico is one of the countries that's pushing forward for regulations to be finished in July. And the reason being is because Mexico is right next to the Clarion-Clipperton Zone, so they're going to become so rich from the amount of use of their ports from their minerals. So they're really trying for regulations to be finished, and they're pushing forward really fast. In the session that we had in March, they were going forward without any debates. And they just wanted to finish as fast as possible. And some of the countries like Costa Rica and Chile, they're asking for a pause. We're trying to hold them back. So we really need to push Mexico on this. And for that, we're trying to get a change petition. There's in change.org. You guys can see that there's a petition there to push for the government of Mexico to say no to deep sea mining. So we need a position from Mexico, which is key. We also need Argentina in this region that's looking forward to regulations. And we need countries that have not ratified UNCLOS, so that means that they don't have a vote, but can send observing delegations to be present there. And which countries are this? We need Venezuela, Colombia, Peru, and the United States, because they can also serve observing delegations even though they can't have a vote. So that is key, to push for countries that are not sending delegations, but that can go and send observers. And the other thing that we can do that is key is countries that can have a vote to assist there. Countries like Uruguay and Bolivia, that are countries that can vote but are never going to the meetings. So this is a key moment in July, and we need to go over there, because in the assembly meetings, which is more than 160 countries going, not only the 36 from the council, they can go there and push for a general policy for a moratorium. And that will be presented and voted on in July. And by that, we need a quorum of 87 countries present. So we need as much as countries present in there. So if wherever you are, whichever part of the world we are, not just the USA, we need a lot of push on this matter.
This is only the start, this session. Take this energy, take all of the relationships you're making during World Oceans Week, and do the littlest thing you can think of.
No, the biggest.
Rinse and repeat. Build, build, build. Last words, John, Sylvia?
Make it happen.
Thank you all for sharing your morning. Last word to Sylvia.
I've said it before, I'll say it again. Protect the ocean as if your life depends on it, because it does.
Ted, where are we going next?
I think we're just
out to the terrace.